So, Dave, before we get started, I want to share another and a Dion song that the group has not heard yet. So let me find that really quick. Here we go.
Everything's falling around me. Fog's so thick I can hardly see. Nothing is holding me up. Everyone's had enough. No one is really connecting. We act like we are all set and inside we're drowning in sorrow that'll come to an end. We've got to calm together in every kind of weather. We are stronger by oh so much more when we're all joined as one. We'll be like a wave that's crashing, driven by divine passionate action. We've got to come together and this world will be saved. A challenge, we turn our doubt into courage. There's nothing we cannot do when we are guided by love. We give not into temptation. Our faith is helping our patience. We're reaching out into space and throughout all of time. We've got to come together. In every kind of weather, we are stronger by oh so much more when we are all joined as one. We'll be like a wave that's crashing, driven by divine passionate action. We've got to come together and this world will be saved. We've got to come together. In every kind of weather, we are stronger by oh so much more when we're all joined as one. We'll be like a wave that's crashing, driven by divine passionate action. We've got to come together and this world will be saved.
Was that awesome?
It was great. Yeah, well done.
Oh, wonderful. Before we go on, I forgot. I also have a giveaway that I wanted to include with Allie. So this is my book, Little Book of Meditations. There are 18 channeled meditations in this book. I'm giving away the e-book, not the paperback, because I don't want to be limited to where I can send it. These were channeled by Archangel Metatron or with him, and they were specially chosen by him because I have a whole collection. So I went through them and it's like, okay, which ones are we putting in the book? These are the 18 that were chosen. And of course, 18 is a very important spiritual number. Now, you'll also get access to audio recordings of all of the meditations with that ebook. So, the lucky winner is Shishi. So, Shishi, grab my email. I just put it there a little bit ago. Send me the email. Let me know how to reach you, and I will get you your ebook. All right, Dave, we're going into hour 9. Can you believe it?
Well done, you're still
Oh
standing.
my gosh. And there are so many people here that have been since the beginning.
Fantastic.
Astonishing. So we've got
Great.
another Founding Father video coming up in a little bit. But for now, I'm just looking forward to getting to know you a little bit.
Yeah, vice versa.
I am so curious. How did you meet the man on the moon?
Wow, that's a great story. I was many years ago, let's see, a long time ago. I don't want to tell you how old I am. No, it was, let's see, 1993. I was in the Peace Corps. And I went to, of all places, Hungary, because, you know, the wall had come down, went to Central Europe. And very difficult. It's very difficult to live in a foreign country where you cannot speak to anyone for about a year. It's just really hard language. And I was having terrible insomnia. I had all these problems. It was just really, really difficult. And somebody said, well, why don't you go see this shaman? We're going. And it completely changed my life. Absolutely. I've been a seeker for a long time. I tried a bunch of, tried religions. I tried, you know, political philosophies. And all of a sudden, just the moment I sat there, I'm like, oh my God, this is it. Right. It was like he and I among 50 people were actually like kind of having a silent conversation. I realized now, and I felt that way then, but I wasn't sure of it. So I soon after, you know, I met him three times and then I came back, and that's the message I got. This go back. And I was using tarot cards because I do read them for myself. And I got back and I'm like, well, I'm going to do this. I was really broke. I couldn't afford to learn from someone. So I mostly learned through books, although I met a few people. And I was doing a vision quest on Mount Shasta. And a vision quest, you go sit on a mountain for 5 or 6 days. You only drink water, you get no food, and you have kind of questions that you journey on. And I had these questions that I was journeying on, and I got really sick. Something happened, and I woke up from a sort of nap with just very strange things going on in my body. I was constantly having indigestion. I felt dizzy. And I'm like, well, you know, maybe this is what's supposed to happen. But this is the first time I asked directly, because I kind of felt this channeling. So I kind of felt a guide. I didn't know what that was. This is the first time where I said, am I supposed to get off this mountain? And I got this, the clearest answer I'd ever gotten. Yes, get off right now. And when I said that, he didn't really give a name. He just kind of showed me. He showed me a hand clearing away to the truth. And I didn't get the name exactly, but I kind of felt that. And so I got up and I almost passed out. What had happened is I'd had an operation a few months before, and the whatever drug they had given me was still in my cells. So when I went down to no food, it was basically, I was gassing myself all day, you know, because I had no food, no other cells to work on. So I kind of kept passing myself out. So it was only because of an emergency that I had even made this contact, which is an interesting thing to tell people who have made this contact. It often comes just an absolutely necessary, dangerous situation that was created. I went down the mountain, I had some eggs, I went back, right, it was all fine. I just needed some food. But I kind of had like, wow, he really showed me who he was, not just by advice, but by this gesture. Many years later, and I continue to work with shamanism, I finally said, I'm not working this job anymore. I'm going to have a new job. And I kept getting a message to channel. And I'm like, well, I don't know how to do that. I kept watching other channels. I don't know what that is. I don't know why I should do it, but I'm getting this message that I should. So I just went and I'm like, well, I'll just test myself, make a fool of myself. I'm going to make my first video. And it was, you know, after Trump had been elected. So I was very much concerned with that. So I just made my first video. I don't know if two people watched in the universe. I made my video. Then I went to pick something up. I had gone to an auction and there was just a bunch of stuff in it, which I didn't want. I just wanted the thing to pot a plant in. But there were a bunch of other things. And I literally made the video, posted it, walked out the door, and I came back and let me show you what was in the box.
Oh my gosh.
And I was like, okay. That was the confirmation I needed. And again, I think I did, you know, probably 5 people watched total. But soon thereafter, I was fortunate enough to be on Lena Rodriguez's channel. And I've had a career ever since. I'm forever in debt to her. But that's how it started. I had not much idea. I didn't even know what channeling really was, although I'd read a couple books on it. I never in a million years dreamed that I would channel. That was totally outside. I thought, oh, well, maybe I'll be able to facilitate some people on their shamanic journey someday when I'm really, truly evolved. I will be able to do that. It's not like that, is it?
No.
It's not like we're finished with our lives and now we start sharing our wisdom. Okay. It's kind of like up, down, up, down, up. Oh, I've got a problem. I guess that'll help others. I got a problem that'll help others. So for all of you out there who are intending to channel or have maybe even the slightest idea of channeling, it isn't so, it's not like you reach a state of perfection, right? It is, you get a call and you start to share. And everyone, I teach people to channel, every single person can do it. Yes. Everyone. It's sometimes it'll take you a little bit longer, but some people are instant. They're just completely ready. And some people have to figure stuff out along the way. You know, I always, when I'm teaching it, ask them to see a doorway. And I always say, before you go through that doorway, check in your heart. Is that the right one? And sometimes people are like, no, it's I don't like that door. No, just push it aside. That's a little trick the universe has to get you to notice your heart. You know, is this, you know, just like when you meet someone and you have an immediate feeling of trouble, you know, you need to listen to that when you're channeling too. It needs to be under your own power. It's not like somebody just comes and starts channeling through you. You go, I need the highest good channel. And maybe on Tuesday and Wednesday, but not all week. You know, that's how it evolved.
Yeah. Do you get songs?
You know, I'm not particularly good at songs. And that's something I'd really like to learn.
Because I get songs all the time. And I think it's, you know, they pick up and use whatever they can from you that you can relate to. So I've always loved music. So, but the problem is I'm older than most of the people around these days. So the songs I'm getting, they don't know what they are.
Oh, well, yeah. That is one thing. Yeah. I would love to do more of the singing and shamanic work.
Ask them to send you more music that you would like. And I bet they will.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. That's exactly what I should do. Can I ask you how you started to read these Akashic records? Because I totally believe in them, but I only know this much about them.
Yeah, well, I didn't even believe in reincarnation years ago. And now I'm dancing in the Akashic records. So it's like they take you through a process where you get desensitized. So for me, the entree was Abraham. I listened to a lot of Abraham. And one day I heard Abraham say, you too can channel. And I thought, oh, well, okay, I will. And it started from there. And then I discovered the Akashic records. And it was like, welcome home, baby. It just, it fit.
Yeah.
And it's been so joyful.
Yeah. For example, if I asked you right now, tell me something about my record. Is that how you work or no?
Yeah, I could. It would take me a moment. I would just, you know, relax like you do, going almost like a trance, connecting with your record and asking for information. Yeah, I do that all the time on my live streams.
Yeah. Right. Terrific. Cool. Is it okay to ask you to do that for me?
Sure. Yeah. What do you want to know?
What's the most pressing question? Well, you know, I'll tell you, I am a little bit, to some degree, moving away from politics. Nothing, I mean, everything is lovely about the show, but I'm guessing in the future, it will be a little less extreme. And I know you probably, when you're doing work in politics, it's actually a lot of hard work for us because you're going some pretty heavy material. You know, you're working through it. It's not all light and stardust. So maybe I would ask what the Akash says about sort of shifting and maybe doing somewhat more healing work.
Oh, I just got a visual of your heart chakra just opening up. Because what you're doing, as you said, it's a little dark. It's a little abrasive for your soul. Yeah. And this is the heart opening up, very warmly embracing you, saying, come on in, Dave. Let's go to the lighter side. Because you've got so much love, so much joy to share with the world. And it doesn't get shared when it's muffled by the darkness of the politics. And that would be more soul satisfying to you.
Mm-hmm.
It will just keep expanding. That kind of happened to me. It was just one day, you know, I didn't like people very much. I'm kind of a hermit and I would be happy to be all alone on my mountaintop. But my soul is wired to be a researcher and then I have to teach what I learned. So if I'm not doing both, I'm unbalanced. And I felt that. And finally, when I said, okay, and I stepped out and started sharing with people, I felt that literally the heart chakra just opening up. And it's like, now I love everybody. And I can't figure that out. Because
Yeah. Again, if you do this work, it will push you into unknown territory.
Yeah.
And that is like the biggest block to doing it. It's like, oh, wow, you know, things are working out well. Now I've got all this responsibility. I can't blame my boss if something goes wrong. You know, it's all on me. And it's 10 in the morning. I've got to do my job today. What do I do? It's terrifying, actually. All of us are a little bit terrified about getting what we want. As we get what we want, then we are responsible for walking the walk. But I'm glad to see you are.
Yeah, and it's just so wonderful. You know, a funny story. One of my books is called The Path to Hearing Angels and Guides. It was, again, channeled from Metatron, teaching people how to channel. Because, as you said, everyone can. So I've been talking to Helen about this for a while, and she keeps telling me, I've tried, but I'm not hearing anything. I said, Helen, trust me, you are. You are just not distinguishing ego from spirit. Mm-hmm. People told me last week, I was doing something or other, and I got it. Oh, it's the intrusive thoughts. That's what it's all about.
Right. It's so funny when you begin working with people, they're like, this is probably my imagination, but after 15 times of saying, it's probably my imagination, go, yeah, go with it. They start to stop saying that.
Yeah.
And they're like, no, it's not my imagination, right? And you know, we live in this world where, you know, we got to be rational and logical a lot of the time. And even the spiritual realm, we don't want to just follow the next person. We do have to be analytical and rational. So figuring out the balance of when do I trust the voice in my brain is, it is a path that we do need to walk. But it is really a gift that people have at this time, because something, it's like a meteor has hit the planet, and what we're calling, I think, the divine feminine has shifted everything. And now there's this window. You can do intuitive work on YouTube and make a living. You really can live in an intuitive world. You really can regress people to their past lives and solve a lot of today's issues. It's like a gift has been delivered to us of intuition. And these are for some of us, our first steps. So if you make a mistake or two, that's what's needed, right? But all of us can do this work right now. And it really is wonderful that even if we're not doing this directly, we can benefit from it and, you know, still go to our day job.
And we need to. The ironic thing is, you know, for years I've been getting these messages about light workers. It's okay to step out and be your true self this lifetime. This is why you're here. So stop hiding because you were killed in all those past lifetimes.
Right. Come out.
And what happens? Project 25, and they're threatening our lives. And I'm like, oh my God, I've been delivering these messages for years, and now you're telling me I've been leading the people the wrong way? But no, we have to go through this fire.
We
do. To get to the other side.
We do. Look, you know, people don't give power away. They don't go, oh yeah, I'm done. Here you go. Unless, of course, you know, you're Joe Biden. People don't. But usually they don't, right? And anytime a new power shows up, there's going to be a reaction. You know, which is why, you know, you talk to these people who were, you know, on that, in that spectrum, they're not rational at all. None of the things make any sense. If we thought about it, if we were truly American about it, we would look immediately and see some of the things that the right has done and say, this is just un-American. Asking a foreign power to break into your opponent's internet and steal their information is clearly un-American. But when you try to be rational with such people, it doesn't work anymore. And that's just, we've reached a sort of limit of rationality, of logic, of that thing we might call maleness. We've reached a limit, right? And I felt it very much myself. I was not good at the heart when I started this work. I went to a therapist once and she said, how do you feel? And I said, let me think about it.
She's just, you were very bad, Jeff.
And now I'm just barely able to access, as a typical American man, my own feelings. That is very powerful.
It is.
I noticed working with Abraham Hicks, because I was watching her too with her at the beginning, that suddenly I realized that how I felt about things, if I thought about a future and I put some really, and I felt really positive about it, that future would actually be created. And it wasn't about, oh, I'm going to do this, and then I'm going to do this, and then I'm going to do this. It wasn't. Don't logic it. It was just like, put that out there as something that could really happen. And I noticed that I started to just feel better. I noticed that I started to be a more pleasant coworker, and that led to better opportunities. I also noticed that that positive thinking, I like to call it positive feeling, really worked in my world. It changed everything. It's the reason why I made it here. I'd say also potentially the reason why I have a wonderful partner. And within a very short time, I got a lot of money out of it too. I don't think it always syncs up for everybody quite so simply, but it certainly did for me. Just putting yourself in a place where you spend 5 minutes in the morning imagining your success and putting it in the heart, it'll just shift your day, if not the world. It'll start to shift your days. It'll start to shift the way that people see you. It'll just, you know, we all worry, if you're just able to go, yeah, that's not helping. That makes your day so much better. You know, worrying about that isn't going to solve that problem. Have I done everything I can? It really does just shift the heart. Do you think that we can change the Akashic records? Do you think I can go in and, you know, you could shift them?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, I do something like your past life regression. I go in and do looking for karmic blocks.
Oh.
Find the story. What was the trauma that happened? What lifetime? What was the thing that happened to cause this thing in life today? Mm-hmm. So when you go in and you find it, you tell the story, the person understands it. And just that understanding starts clearing the energy. But right. Then we do a clearing ritual. And that actually, it was described to me like this. Think of a hard drive, you know, the platter of a hard drive. So they go in where we do the clearing and they change just that little bit of the trauma. They override it. Not the lesson. You keep the lesson, but yeah. You lose the trauma.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Once people, when they do past life regression, whatever the lesson was in there, often they've already learned the lesson, they just don't acknowledge it. Right. So one thing that I do after past life regression is I try to go, hey, look at the brilliant success that you are. And it's true for everyone, right? That people are doing brilliant things every day of their lives and going beyond their known safe abilities. And once they get that, it's like everything shifts and changes. And in some ways, it's almost like, well, this is why you're scared of mountains. Oh, now that they get that, oh, I got thrown off one in a lifetime. That's why I'm scared of mountains. Okay. I was also very scared of doing spiritual work. Because I've had plenty of lifetimes where I was greatly harmed for doing that. Yeah. So it's good to know in this lifetime, one thing I have realized is they can't really hurt you.
No, it's so liberating.
It's so liberating. Yeah, yeah. It's great that we do now. I mean, the medium that we're using has so many negatives, but it also has these terrific positives. You know, we couldn't meet today without it.
Yeah. We did a live a couple of weeks ago where I was guided to say a prayer for Donald Trump. I don't want to say a prayer for Donald Trump, but yes. They keep telling me, you need to stop thinking of all the negative stuff about this man. You need to say a prayer, wish him well, and that will shift the world. So right. He did it, you know. Yeah. Hopefully it's happening, it's rippling out there, but that's what we can do. We can stop focusing on him all the time, which the news does incessantly. We can start focusing on the joy and the positivity.
Right, right. And you realize for most news channels, they're not going to have an hour of joy and positivity for you, right? No. I am like everybody else, naturally go to the stress on the net. I naturally go to the most stressful thing. And that's what Donald Trump is. He's just something to talk about as well as being what he is. But, you know, who knows what his childhood was like?
We know something about it because we know what the trauma that he had at 3 with his mother. But, you know, that doesn't excuse it. He came here with so much potential. I was shown the past life that he had with him. And he was Brutus, Putin was Caesar, and the two of them had that old karma. So they came in this lifetime with good intentions to resolve that karma. But then they resorted back to the old energy and look what they've done.
Yep. Yeah. I think people tend to fall back into the energy that they used the last time around.
Repeating patterns. Yeah.
Yeah.
So he failed. He'll have to do it all over again. He could have done so many wonderful things if he'd gone the other way.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. We can't control him, but we can control our reaction, and we can reap the benefits because there have been some benefits.
Well, he came to expose the corruption so that it could be transmuted.
Yes.
He didn't have to do it this way, but right. He did it. He exposed all the corruption. He's ripped it clear off so we can clearly see it. And now we can clean it up.
Yeah. Great point. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we should take a little break and get that Founding Father video in here.
Okay.
So let me bring that up. We are going to hear from President James Monroe now. We have 12 of these videos, so they're interlaced through the whole event. All right. Where are you? I know I put these things in the right order, but for some reason, I'm not seeing them in the right order. You know what it is? It's when we go to AM and PM, I get confused with the folders.
I get it. Yeah.
Here we go. James Monroe.
Covering the Founding Fathers to dispel misinformation and the prevailing attitude for many people, fundamentalists, people on the right, Republican right wing, who believe this is a Christian country and everything should be based on Christian beliefs, essentially a theocracy, the farthest thing from the intention of the Founding Fathers. And we're up to number 5, right? James Monroe. And if you haven't heard the other little pieces that we've done, there are some very interesting quotations from the founding fathers that should dispel people's mistaken notions. So Monroe died on July 4th, the third founding father. Adams and Jefferson all died on the 4th of July. He fought alongside Washington at Valley Forge. He was a close friend of Lafayette. I always thought Lafayette was a really interesting character in history, right?
Yeah.
Monroe, now this guy was interesting. He was a believer in the Stoic philosophy of Epictetus or Epictetus. I believe it's Greek, and I'm not conversant with how to pronounce Greek, so, you know, I'm pronouncing it like the Romans would. That's not right. Anyway, their belief system was basically, you know, people think Stoicism means complete unemotionality and not seeking creature comforts, and that's not really entirely true. They believe that the good is the only worthwhile object of our earnest pursuit, and it can only be found within. All is based in free will. So those are some inherent belief systems that were taken into the Enlightenment worldview that they brought to the establishment of the country. He followed this interesting trajectory. He was governor of Virginia. He was ambassador to France and England. He was the 7th Secretary of State. He was the 8th Secretary of War, and he became the 5th President of the United States. He was also the last founding father to be president. And at that point, they kind of aged out. It was the next generation. He was a deist, yet again, another founding father who did not believe in an involved God. Creator made us and then left us to figure it out. But he refused to discuss religion in public at all. Under his administration, there was aggressive expansionism domestically, the Louisiana Purchase and the Monroe Doctrine, which was the U.S. in opposition to foreign intervention in any new country, which I just find such a contradiction. Here they are decreeing, we can push forward. We're getting this land, you know, Louisiana. We're getting, I think they got Florida at the same time. They were negotiating with France and Spain. Got a lot of land in the Louisiana Purchase. It was okay to take that from the Native Americans. That was fine. But at the same time, he didn't want any other country to get involved in other countries' business. And so it would be our job to go figure that out, you know, the policemen of the world, right? That's where that began. So he was instrumental in the Missouri Compromise. Missouri entered the Union as a slave state. And after that, slavery would be forbidden north of 3630, you know, the latitude, yeah, latitude. He claimed to oppose slavery. He called it a blight. He was an advocate of sending freed slaves to Liberia. And actually, the capital of Liberia, Monrovia, is named after President Monroe. So, question. You supported the stealing of Native American land and the destruction of their cultures, but you did not abolish slavery when you were the president. So how did you justify fighting and almost dying? He almost died in the Revolutionary War. How did you justify almost dying in a war for liberty, but you were denying fellow human beings their basic human freedoms, especially in light of your Stoic principles?
There simply is no justification. What we did can only be described as crimes against humanity. At the time, we did not see it that way. We looked upon the Native Americans and the slaves as something less than the superior white man. I'm ashamed to say, we looked upon them as being closer to animals than people.
Yeah.
We took what we wanted because we were the superior beings. It is a great stain upon my name, which I carry to this day. Despite my principles, I looked the other way too often because that was the easier path. Yes, I was a coward.
Well, now I feel really guilty. I'm scolding all the founding fathers. But what we're really trying to do here, I think, is figure out how not to repeat these kind of things. What can I ask you to ask this question? It wasn't on the list.
Yeah, go ahead.
How do we figure these things out for ourselves today? How do we know? I mean, they advocated for the good, and they said you found it within, and free will was instrumental in that. what would he suggest we do to avoid the kinds of judgment errors in moral choices? Because we're all human, we all make them. How do we learn from his mistakes?
So we're asking this of Monroe.
Sure.
Okay. So President Monroe, what would you suggest that we do so that we don't fall into the same pits that you did? How can we learn from your mistakes to do better? What would you suggest? Well, first of all, recognizing that every being is equal to every other being. Those old beliefs were never true, and they must go away. That is holding the country back, the racism, the bigotry. After that, it wouldn't hurt you to remember the golden rule. Bring that sensibility back to your society, live it, practice it. That will change your world. But you must adhere to that principle. It's not, I'll practice the golden rule today when it suits me, but I'll break it tomorrow when it doesn't suit me. It is living by the principles, by your own values, not discarding them when it suits your purposes. Live and be who you were created to be, a divine being who does unto others as they would have done unto themselves.
Thank you for that, because I agree. I approve of this message. I'm so tickled while you were talking. You know how little notifications drop down?
Yeah.
And I find them enormously annoying, distracting. But this one really caught my eye while you were talking about living the golden rule and not being a hypocrite. A little notification dropped down. The Lincoln Project's new ad is called Hypocrisy.
Oh my.
I love it.
I like that.
Just love it.
Wow, great reading.
That was fun.
Yeah, that is fun. Yeah.
You have to go on and do that with Helen. It is just, she asks the best questions.
Oh, I'll totally do it. Absolutely. No, I love her show. Now, have you gone and chatted with many presidents?
I tried Lincoln at one point and he was like, no, leave me alone. I've had enough, because so many people are knocking on his door. And it's like, hey, no problem. But the ones that she brought up, that was my first go around with the presidents. And I don't know if you heard the one with George Washington. She wanted to know who his favorite president was. He said, Grant. And we were both astonished. Grant? But
yeah.
He explained. They were both generals. He understood what Grant went through. He empathized with him, especially because he went through the Civil War. He had to deal with all of that. And he dealt with it in a very honorable way. And Washington liked that.
Yeah, that does make some sense now that you say it like that. You do need it, you know, we did need a general, not just a president at that time, right? And he got a terrible rap. For many years, people said terrible things about him, which turned out not to be true. It was believed that he was an alcoholic, and that just must have been created by his enemies, because they went to the original, you know, writings, and they're like, you know, he had half a glass of wine, which is not something alcoholics do. So he got a terrible rap, much like propaganda of today.
The paparazzi, right? Well, that series is going to be on Helen's channel probably in a week or so. So everybody can still get them. We just wanted to give them a taste of it here.
Hey, good one.
Yeah.
Always interesting to talk about the founding fathers, because of course we are the founding fathers, right? You know, they were our elected officials. So what they think is not more important than what we think. It is supposed to be a representation of what we think. And whenever I think of that time, I have ancestors that were alive at that time.
Yeah.
Like, this isn't an aristocracy. These people were supposed to be representatives for all of us. And that's the way that the Senate's supposed to work now. But it doesn't really. It's so meted out in particular ways, you know, that the way that the gerrymandering has worked and the way that the electoral college has worked, it's not the reflection of us that it used to be.
No.
It's one reason why I think we need a change is one reason why I think Kamala is going to be great is that we have to have somebody that understands these laws really well and is pretty aggressive, because we can't live in a society that's not a democracy. This is inevitable. If we live in a society that's not a democracy, eventually it will be so out of balance that it needs to be righted. Trump should have never been president. He was not elected.
No, he stole it, clearly. Absolutely. He stole it. Do you feel like you dodged a bullet? You got out before all this mayhem started?
I swear to God, it was just so incredibly lucky. And again, I did not consider myself a psychic, but 3 days before the election, I'm in, you know, standing at the beach in Australia. I went camping. There's great camping here, by the way. Because you're going to be completely alone. I'm alone on the beach and I'm out of these rocks. And in Australia, sometimes there are these rogue waves. So you'd be like, oh, I could stand on that rock, no problem. And then 5 minutes later, you're like, oh my God, I would be dead if I were standing on that rock. Because a gigantic wave will hit. And that's exactly what happened. And I looked at that wave and I'm like, oh my God, he's going to win. And I knew right then he was going to win. And I told my partner, it's going to be really, really bad. And he said, well, maybe it'll be okay. And a month later, he's like, you're right, he's going to be just as bad as you said he's going to be. But there are so many lessons here. And those founding fathers were enlightened people, right? They were moving in a particular trajectory. You know, I'm actually descended from some Quaker people, specifically the ones on Nantucket Island. And it's actually a woman that changed everybody's mind. Because in Quakerism, women and men, anybody who wants to can speak, they're all equal. She convinced all of those ship captains that slavery was wrong and they should be Quakers and they shouldn't have it. So that woman probably prevented perhaps tens of millions of people being enslaved. I always think it's so interesting that the religion which allowed women in, that those women helped to convince people that slavery was wrong. And they succeeded.
And thank God for them.
Yeah, yeah, the power of their ability. Yeah, in Quakerism, you're just like, God's speaking to me. And, you know, it's a lot like channeling, actually. They were formidable in stopping slavery.
Yeah, you're going to love, later on, we have Benjamin Franklin coming up, if you're still awake.
Oh, yeah, he's also from Nantucket. Yeah, fascinating.
Yeah, it really was fascinating. Should we do a couple of questions for people? Because we haven't done it in an hour.
Yeah.
You have a hot question for us, Sherry?
Oh. Assign him as clinically insane. Let's see.
Okay.
Do you mean, I think she means Melania. Because Ivanka has died. As Ivanka's daughter.
Ivanka's the daughter. So the daughter.
Okay, I was the daughter and the mom confused.
If the wife leaves, you know, then the daughter could.
Okay, let's see what Ivanka thinks. Yeah, so there's Ivana and Ivanka. So, there's a lot of hair flipping going on here. It's funny to see her doing that. She's quite aloof, isn't she? Just like she was when she was working in the White House. I don't think so. I find her to be totally aloof and almost to the point of not caring. I feel like at some point in her life, for her own psychological survival, she just almost becomes like she's in an ivory tower. She's almost just gets distant from everything that's going on because she never felt that she could change anything. And that's where I feel that she's going now. She's just going to keep as much distance from this as possible. Also, she doesn't want to get in trouble.
Yeah. I feel the distance, you know, she is loath to do that. She wants to be hands off at this point. But there's also that side of her where this is about dog eat dog, take care of number one first, like daddy taught her. So if it was something that would benefit her, she would do it in a heartbeat.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. And she is thinking about her preservation, you know, and she's the only one so far that is coming out of this smelling like a rose. What did her husband get, like $100 million?
Yeah, but I don't think she's smelling like a rose. They've been shunned.
True, but they're not broke. Trump's on his way to broke. They could easily take that money and move to anywhere on the planet and never encounter another a contradictory opinion in their lives.
But you know, Jared, you know what they say about when you lie down with dogs?
Yeah, yeah.
Some day could come. And you know, he's got a boatload of karma for that whole thing about the reporter. What was
Khashoggi. That's there's some karma going on there too. What an unpleasant person.
Craziness. So we still have a little time if you got another question for us, Sherry.
Will he be sentenced on September 18th? That's good. Is it yes? You want me to start?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Okay, I'm looking at the judge. Judge is kind of giving me a serious look. I get the feeling that it's delayed 2 days. Just the judgment is delayed 2 days, but it could only be 1 day.
Yeah, it's not decided yet. They are still doing these behind the scenes maneuvers.
Yeah.
So it's not like Mershon can just lock it in because there are all these other things that keep coming in, the things that Trump does.
Right.
Mershon is like standing on a bunch of water bottles floating in the lake. You know, he's like this and trying to get his footing so that he can do something.
Yeah. Yeah. Difficult job, that poor man. But no, I think I'm going to concur and say I think it'll be delayed a little bit. Yeah.
Boy, I don't envy him at all. And, you know, it's such a crime what they have done to his family. You know, in America, just because of who your family is now.
It's shocking.
It's horrid.
Right. It's shocking that they can get away with posting your name in public. That should not be allowed. Right.
Yeah. And, you know, you look at the list of crimes that you could attach to Trump. The judge who had it was either her son or her husband got killed because she was going to be overseeing a case. And this was some years back.
Right.
Happened with Pelosi, which is still tied to the same source. All of these things. It's you know, if he's not mafia, he ought to be.
Basically, he is. It's just a different, a lighter, one that mafia than we are used to. It just looks a little bit different.
Yeah.
You're right. Should we take another one?
Sure.
We're on a roll. And then right back, Lunar Love and Light. I see a person and they're happily riding forward on their horse, but there's a little bit of looking back, like, what was the meaning of that? What did that mean? Maybe still trying to reconcile things from childhood. I kind of have a feeling that, I want to say that's okay. There can be, throughout your life, you will be reconciling things from an earlier time. And that is incorporated in moving forward. So don't worry. Obviously, you don't want to stay stuck in the past. But if you look at the past and it informs the future, that's fine. But also when you're doing that, you'll have a strong emotional reactions. So you can go back to trauma at 5 and you'll be traumatized for a while. When you do go back, don't hesitate to ground that information and reparent the self. Go to the 5-year-old self and comfort them. I think that's what you're getting. It's just there's some things that are coming up from the past and you're trying to reconcile them. There's nothing wrong with that. Don't hesitate to find ways to do that on the internet. Look at people, how they reconcile issues from the past. It's a process, which is an important one.
Yeah, I get a picture of this sidewalk that is rolling out, unfurling in front of you like a carpet. And as you walk forward, these daisies are popping up all along the sides. And it's like, hello, we are laying the path for you. Just walk out with confidence and do it. Stop second guessing yourself. The path is there. Just take it already, baby.
Good one. Yeah, terrific. Should we try another?
Sure. We've got 10 more minutes, and then we're going to have Sherry and Ramon come up and take our places here.
Oh, good. Okay.
So Ramon's not here yet.
So Phoenix, financial situation changing and improving. Let's see, Phoenix. So I see like paper money being folded in half. I kind of feel like, there's some way that you could double the money or save the money, right? So if you find a way, if you half your rent, that's better than a salary increase, right? There's something there, something that you can look at as a cost that could be halved fairly easily if you are, realistic. Consider those. Also just consider ideas, things that could make you money or again, save you money. I don't see a bad future. I see a positive one, but it involves looking at something quite differently or looking at something almost halved so that you're really focusing on something. Consider that.
So I get this picture of you gazing into this pool of murky water, and it's really murky. It's got like an oil slick on top of it. So you're trying really, really hard to get clarity. Like it's almost like you're using it like a crystal ball or something, but it's water. So you can't force it to get clarity when it's got that oil slick on top of it. You got to go find another pond, honey. This is the wrong one. So find another pond that's got clarity. Stop wasting your time there. It's like you're knocking on the wrong door, right? So go find the one that you can see clearly, and then you will have your path and your answers.
Great advice.
So we still got a couple more minutes to do some more if we have other questions waiting. Oh, sorry about that, Maria.
Yeah. Let's take a look. There are several different ways to shift this. First of all, don't hesitate to show respect for the sadness. Now, there's probably some really legitimate information there, which does need to be encountered. You know, life is all about shoving sadness and unhappiness into one corner and never dealing with it. It's going to come back and it's going to come up. I would consider working with others, if not yourself, and sort of going back to the sad selves and learning more about them. At the same time, this has got to be counterbalanced with more fun, more quiet, and just more joy. While you just think about it sometimes, don't spend the entire day thinking about it. Give yourself a certain set amount of time and look at some of these things and see where their origin is and deal with them in that way. And at the same time, there has to be a counter. You walking through the garden, you doing something else. Again, I think these are legitimate things to think about. Don't hesitate to join a group, any spiritual group that's doing this kind of work. Because if you do that, there will be others who will help you walk through it. And as you walk through that, they will give you a lot of joy. New friends, new encounters, new experiences, they will bring you happiness. Whatever you do, don't spend your time at home worrying about it. Go and go meet others. And if they're not willing to talk to you about these things, then they're not appropriate at this time. Meet people who are doing deep things and who are able to help you. What do you get?
I'm trying to remember.
That's all right.
Oh, okay. So the thing about it is, Maria, a move, wherever you go, you are still going to be there. So you're not going to simply get rid of depression by moving. And if you haven't seen a doctor to be sure that it's not a biological issue, that would be wise. It's always wise to check that out. You know, we're not doctors, so we can only tell you what we get. But it feels like I get this visual of you like picking at the scab. There's something that you're worrying and worrying, not letting it heal. But it's also like something that wants to emerge. Ooh, and now I'm getting it coming up. Oh my gosh. Look, it's coming up. My chest and wanting to come out my throat. There's something you're repressing that you need to let go of. I don't know if it's, it feels like you need to say something to somebody that you've been trying to hold back, and it's eating you up from the inside out. Oh my gosh, it really feels putrid in my stomach. So let that out. Don't keep it in there. It's harming you keeping it in there. Once you release it, then do some self-care. Let yourself heal from that. And then you can stop picking at that scab. And then maybe if you feel better, a move could be good. But first, you've got to take care of this issue. You can't keep running away and avoiding it.
Fantastic. Ready for one more?
Yeah, I think we have time for one more.
Okay. The slurred speech on Twitter interview. Yeah, to a home visit from Dr. Ryan. Oh, they're like, did he get drugged? That's a great question.
Yeah.
I kind of get the opposite. I think they usually drug him, but he's like, no, I'm not going to do it. I think when you see Trump not slurred, that's unusual. Okay. I think what he is usually doing is drugging. He's being drugged by Ronnie so that he can perform. And this is tricky business because, you know, you got to keep that drug just right. I see him getting an injection. So I think that he, in his arrogance, waved Ronnie off and insisted he's knows what he is doing, which is, again, his error, his mistake. He's just arrogant. Yeah.
I got a very distinct jab in the right cheek. So I think what they did was they gave him a vitamin B shot and let him think that it was drugs, trying to get that psychosomatic thing going. Because he wanted something. They had to do it. They can't say no to him.
Right.
And then it didn't work. So I'm sure he read them the riot act afterwards.
Uh-huh. Right. Would you like to work for Donald Trump? Thank your lucky stars. You're not working
for him. How on earth?
Yeah. And I'll tell you, and one thing that's the same is I did see a needle. I just saw Trump waving them away. So we don't know exactly what that means. Maybe he did get the shot, right?
Yeah, great. It's one that's hard to tell because anything is possible. Dave, tell us what your giveaway is.
So the giveaway is indeed a past life regression. A lot of people don't know what that is. It can also be, you know, quantum healing and past life regression are sort of parallel things. They're sort of different methods of hypnosis where you take people to past lives and you resolve some things. So in my work, I have people submit 7 questions about anything in their lives, not about the future, present or past. And then we go through this regression. Now, it takes a little bit of time. You got to allow about 3 hours to do it. It is a event, but I find it to be life-changing, and people will come out of it, and I record you while you're in this event. So the client is the one who's saying all this. I'm not talking, I'm not channeling. You are the one that's channeling if you are the client, and you'll be amazed. You'll look at yourself in the video and be like, oh my god, how do I know so much about saddling a horse, you know, like in the 16th century. I tell you, every single person who sees themselves is absolutely amazed that they went. And you can look at many channels that show past life regressions. There are some out there who are really, really worthwhile. But I find this process to be really empowering for clients because it's not just that we're giving that information. They're getting that information through themselves. And it's just builds a lot of they really believe what they are them saying themselves because they are saying it themselves. So that's it. Yeah, that's what I'm giving away.
That's cool. Now, is it QHHT that you do, the Dolores Cannon?
Yes.
Awesome. So this now, go ahead.
When I say QHHT, Dolores at that time didn't want people to do it online. So technically, I'm not allowed to say that because when she was alive, there was only Skype and it kept dropping out and she was afraid your client would be there in the middle of hypnosis. Things have changed. And I've talked to Dolores about this and she's like, go forward. But I'm not sure if I'm technically allowed to call it that because on paper, she did not want people to do that. So I learned a lot from her and I did take the course, but I've combined it with my own stuff, but yeah.
And when you say you've talked to her on the other side or before she passed?
On the other side.